Morning, guys. Thank you for plugging in. I always believe when people plug into these kind of things, it's because you're looking for something to maybe pull you along, especially through these times, these difficult times, unprecedented times that we're in. And it's always a privilege and honor for me to get on, whether that's a Zoom call or a Teams call, and deliver talks and, you know, share some inspiration and positivity, which I hope I can do this morning to all of you. And, you know, I always believe life is to be lived forwards but understood backwards. So for the next 45 minutes to an hour, I'll just share a little bit about my journey, but also connect the dots going backwards to how it all began for me, where I've been, and what I'm up to now and where I'm going. And I think that's really important for me to share some of the experiences that I've had, because if there's anything that you can resonate with in this next 45 minutes to an hour, I always encourage people to soak it up like a sponge, take some notes, and use this time really to great benefit. And you know, it's always, like I say, it's an honor for me to always share my journey too. So what I would like to do now is just share a screen with you before we get going. I would just like to say this. One thing that I've noticed when it comes to personal growth, and of course I'm on that journey now where I'm helping thousands of people through this line of work that I do now with NAC, Nathan Arnold Coaching. And I always say to people, you know, what a perfect time in that now this pandemic's happened, in this self-isolation, to actually reconnect with yourself. I think we live a fast-paced life where we're always on this treadmill of life, you know, this conveyor belt, and it's a real good opportunity now just to slow down, just to exhale. And I use the analogy like an iPhone. You know, we have an iPhone, and every 3 months or every year or 2 years, you know, we'll upgrade. And when you upgrade your iPhone, it normally means that you have to part with your old phone. And unfortunately, we don't carry that through with the mindset of upgrading ourselves. And I think it's a really good time now just to upgrade ourselves, you know, reading books, learning new things, preparing for when we come through the other side. And I'm going to talk a little bit more in detail about this, but this morning is about living with purpose. So I just wanted to share with you first and foremost exactly what kind of work that I've been doing, and then we'll move into it.
She just wants to be beautiful. She goes unnoticed. She knows no limits. She craves attention. She praises an image. She prays to be sculpted by the sculptor. Oh, she don't see the light that's shining deeper than the eyes can find it. Maybe we are made of blind souls. She tries to cover up her pain and cut her woes away, 'cause cover girls don't cry after the face is made. But there's a hope that's waiting for you.
Even with this 1-1 scoreline, even with that Matt Reed equaliser,
Arnold to win the contest. Arnold to break it. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones in today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories, bring back your...
Thanks, guys. The reason why I wanted to just share that video with you is just to skim over, really, the football side of things. I can't ignore that because that has been a great vehicle and it's served as a great vehicle to get me to the place where I am today. I wouldn't have been in the position that I'm in today if it wasn't for football. Football, I've took a lot from that. You know, I always believe in football during my career. I could learn more in 3 months than life in 3 years, with the ups and downs, the setbacks, the difficulties, the challenges along the way. It really does build your character and the resilience that you need. And I'll talk a little bit more in depth about that. But of course, living with purpose and it is the subject today. And the sea turtle, as you can see, my logo with my business, Nathan Arnold Coaching, the sea turtle represents leading with your heart. You know, if you're unaware of the sea turtle is born on land, born in the sand, but makes its way directly to the ocean without any training, without any advice, without any education. The sea turtle heads straight for the water because it knows it's created to be in the water. And in this quote here, this is what I believe. Every single human being on this planet is born with a gift packed away on our back. And it's up to us to discover what that gift is for us and then go in that direction of what's on our heart. And I'll talk more in depth as we go along about this, but I can now move into some of the successes that I had with playing against Arsenal in the top left-hand corner against Alexis Sanchez, brushing shoulders with the likes of him. And meeting my idol in the middle with Thierry Henry, I spent 2 hours just soaking him up like a sponge, put training wheels on myself and just tried to gather as enough information as possible from somebody that has been to the very top and has been successful. And then the champagne spraying and the trophies that have been lifted, which I'll go into pretty soon. So with Nathan Arnold Coaching, moving away from football, making a conscious decision at 30 to actually, you know, move into this line of work and giving service to others. Fortunately, football, and I mean this in the most humblest way, has placed me in such a privileged position in order to have a voice. And I've gone into schools. This is where it all began for me. I went into primary schools and secondary schools just doing assemblies. And then I went into colleges, universities, sports teams, prisons and businesses as well. So I started this business last year in October. I had all the notes in my drawer. I had all the ideas locked away in my office. And I thought, what would it be? What would it look like if I was 85 years old and I had my children and grandchildren around my bedside in the nursing home? And I look back and I didn't use all my stuff. And that's what I believe that's in us all, with the ideas, the talents, the ability that's inside us all. Who would I be to not... sorry, George, I just heard there's some noise in there. I'm not sure whether...
Can't hear it.
Someone needs to...
Sorry.
And I thought to myself, who would I be if I get to the end of my life and I look back and I've kept all my dreams, goals, ideas still in me? And that's what scared me. So I got all my ideas, got all my notes, and I thought, I'm going to take the courage to listen to what's on my heart and start Nathan Arnold Coaching. And I'm so glad I did. I've managed to reach 25,000 people now in the last 18 months. And it's been fantastic. So today, living with purpose, I said at the front end of this call that life is to be lived forward but understood backwards. And I think it's so easy for us to just drift through life and we fall into a job, a career, whatever that may be. And I think sometimes we don't want to revisit hard times, setbacks that we've had, hardships, adversities. And I think it's so easy to lock it away in a box, and it comes timely because of the Mental Health Awareness Week that we're in, is to just go back a little bit to where it all began, and then go from there, because I think sometimes we don't understand our life up until this point. And when we do unpack it and we connect the dots going backwards, it can give us a real sense of purpose in life. And I'll talk in more detail about this. So I was born into a family where there was me, my mum, my nan, and my sister. My father was absent. I didn't go on to meet my father till I was 20. We grew up in a two-bedroom council house where my nan worked two jobs to provide meals on the table for me and my sister. And my mother was on welfare, suffering from depression. From an early age, I was exposed to domestic violence. My mother was in some abusive relationships. And going back to this house, I used to see things like the electricity used to cut off and the candles came on. And my mother used to send me out with a note at a very young age to borrow some milk, sugar, bread, because we couldn't afford it. And I thought everybody was living like this until I went and got invited over to my friend's 6th birthday party. And I realized that, you know, they've got all this food and they've got a nice big plasma on the wall. And I realized that, you know, maybe it's just the way that we're living. And it was real hard times coming up. It was a real hard coursework that I was assigned to from a very young age. And in this environment, I look over my left shoulder, there was drug dealers. I look over my right shoulder, there's people robbing each other, people in and out of prison. So you can imagine what kind of environment it was growing up. And the happiest times when I was growing up was when a ball was at my feet. I didn't know that I would go on to have the career that I did, but all I knew is that whenever I was to play football and watch football on the television, it brought me great happiness and joy. And my earliest memory, really, in my childhood was when I was at school and I was 8 years old. And I can remember having my thumbs tucked into my rucksack one morning, stood in the archway of my classroom. And my teacher, Mrs. Oldsworth, was gathering my tray, which had my name on it. And I was being shipped out to another class. I didn't know whether there was too many numbers in this class. I didn't know the reason, but I just followed orders. And I can remember getting placed from normal education into this other classroom where it was special education, where there was 5 other mentally ill children. Now, in that, I didn't know that her decision by placing me into this facility, this classroom, was going to define my childhood at school through to adolescent stage and even early adult life. And when I got placed in this facility, it was called Young Potential. Now, like any 8-year-old would, I started to make stories up about myself, that I was the dumb child, that I lacked. So lack and limitation was ingrained then. And I would take myself off to the playground and I would try and hang around with a group of guys on one end of the playground and sag my pants and try and fit in there. And if I was unsuccessful, then I'd go over to the other side of the playground and I'd start to hang around with the rebels. And what I noticed is that when I went home, again, I was a different person. And what I did was I spread myself that thin and created so many different identities of who I was, that I was very lost as a child. And again, this goes back to maybe my father being absent and a sense of abandonment and rejection. And I carried that through. Unconsciously did I know that it was affecting my behavior, my attitude, but football was really an opportunity for me to stay on the right path. And this lady here, Miss Doughty, I met her about 4 years ago. Prior to meeting her, I didn't see her for 15 years, but when I got placed into this facility where there was 5 other mentally ill children, she was a volunteer. Same smile, same glow, same volunteer bib, and just a really charitable lady, wonderful lady. And I always remember what she said to me when Mrs. Oldsworth placed me into this facility. And at the time it didn't land, I'm only 8 years old, so I couldn't process it properly. But what this lady said to me was, never allow Mrs. Oldsworth's opinion of you to become your truth. And of course, in hindsight, looking back, I really appreciate that message, because really what she was saying is never allow someone's opinion of you to become your reality. And unfortunately, I did. But what a powerful message that was to a young child who was just been placed from normal education to special education. And it was the first real person that came into my life that invested in me and invested a little bit of belief in me. And when I was around 8-9 years old, I can remember how I got into football, and I would take a football every day and I'd just kick against the wall. And I can remember making up a game in my head and imagining that every window that I could see, be it a car or a house on my street, Sir Alex Ferguson, all these top managers and top scouts was watching me. It's just a game that I used to play using my imagination. And I can remember doing this. Little did I know that I was actually manifesting something. And what happened was there was this guy called Mark Hemingway. And it was always my cue once the streetlights come on at night for me to go in. And I can remember one night this car was approaching me, and the closer it got to me, the slower it became. And the lights just come on. I was just about to grab my ball and go in, and this guy wind his window down, same tracksuit, Mansfield Town. And I could see that he was quite a sporty person. I was really excited, and he wound the window down and he said, "Do you like to play football?" I said, "Yeah, I love to play football." He said, "Do you play for a team?" I said, "No." He said, "Would you like to play organized sport?" And I thought, well, you know, I'm playing tackle football in the street. I'm getting all bloody. My knees are all turfed up. I'd love to, you know, put on a kit and be a part of something. And I can remember him saying, you know, "Will you go inside and get your guardian?" So I went inside, got my mum and nan. My mum and nan came out, and he said, I drive past here every night on the way home from work. And he said to my mum and nan, "Rain or shine, you know, your son plays by himself with a football, and I've seen that he's got some skills. Would like to invite him for a trial at Mansfield Town." And just before he could finish, my mum was very negative. My mum said, "We haven't got no money, we can't afford it, and we don't drive. Thank you, great gesture, but unfortunately my son won't be able to come." And obviously I was tapping her leg, begging her, pleading with her to let me go. And I talked my mum round, and the guy said, "Look, if you have got no money and you can't get there, bring him out here, the same spot. And next week I will come, I'll pick him up, and not only will I take him to training, but I'll also cover his fees as well." So the lady, Miss Doughty, and Mark Hemingway was such a significant, played such a significant role as a child. And he was really my first father figure, like in my role model in my life. And he gave me an opportunity. And off the back of that, I got into organized sport for the very first time. And it was the very first time, because I'd seen my mum in some rough relationships and I was exposed to domestic violence, it was such an opportunity for me now to say, well, I can pull my mum and nan out of certain situations now because I've got such an opportunity with football for it to be a vehicle to be able to, you know, accumulate some money and serve a purpose. So that was my real first time that I committed to something. And commitment is staying true to what you said you was going to do long after the mood you said it in has left. I've spoken to thousands of people all around the UK, and I always ask the same question. How many people in this room, or whoever's with me at the time, who wants to be successful? And guarantee everybody puts their hand up, because of course we all want to be successful. But it's what you do when you leave here, when the music stops, when the shouting dies down, when you're by yourself, your behaviors, whether you're writing goals down, whether you're opening up a book or putting on Netflix, that commitment, that sacrifice, that dedication is what will lead to you being successful, and that will define your future. So this was a real opportunity for me to commit to football, which I did. And I spent the next 11 years from that man meeting me in the street and giving me an opportunity to go and make it as a professional footballer, making my debut at 17. And I had some fantastic times at Mansfield Town. From there, I went to Elphington Town, a small club in Derbyshire, which had another fantastic 3 years. And in my third year, I was 24 and I had a moment. I was always a little bit different in terms of I was a deep thinker and I was a little bit of an introvert. But I can remember for the first time at 24 having a private practice of prayer. And when I say this, I'm not a religious person. I've never stepped foot in church, never been encouraged to do that. So when I say private practice of prayer, what I mean was that I was praying, but it was always selfish prayers. It was always, you know, what can Nathan get? And I can remember being on my knees one day, praying in my room, and I was asking, I want to be a professional footballer. I want to play at the top. I want to be an elite Premiership footballer. And something happened when I was 24 at Alfreton. I'd go out, again, product your environment. I would have all my friends around me. By this point, I've made it. I'm a professional footballer. And so I was getting caught up. I was getting distracted. And I can remember this one incident in a nightclub once when me and my friends was having a drink, and there was a fight what broke out, normally happens. So the DJ cuts the music, bouncer normally comes, escorts him out, and you get on with the rest of your night. And this one particular night, fight broke out, and the guy got pushed into a bar, and the guy turned around, picked a glass bottle off the bar, and he went to glass the guy over the head. And unfortunately for me, I was stood directly in line with the other guy, and as it slipped out of his hand, it hit me directly in the face. And I can remember blacking out. And as I was on my way to hospital, I woke up in the taxi and didn't really know what had happened. And when I got into the hospital, the nightclub owners had patched me up by this point. I can remember sat in front of the specialist, and the specialist said to me, "You're very lucky. If that was 2 inches lower, you'd be blind for the rest of your life." Now, the reason why I talk about prayer and private practice of prayer, me praying, what I've got to understand in that moment was that I was asking God, universe, source, whatever's on the door for people. I was asking, praying to God that I wanted to be a professional footballer, yet my actions was completely different. So matching your words with your actions, I wasn't doing that. I was saying I want to be a professional footballer, yet I was partying, drinking and doing all of that stuff, what wasn't moving me closer to my goals and my dreams and aspirations. So the lesson that I had, again, the iPhone, I had to upgrade my life. You know, I had to upgrade my friendships, I had to upgrade my relationships, I had to upgrade my health, I had to upgrade my habits, I had to upgrade my behaviors, my attitude. And from there, that was a real starting point of me going on a personal development journey, starting to adjust my life accordingly to what my dreams, goals and aspirations was. Because when you go back to the commitment, my commitment was to get my mum and nan out of those situations that they was in. So that was my driving force. From Alfreton Town at 24, I got a move for £50,000 to Cambridge. And I spent a year there before signing for Grimsby. The first season at Grimsby, we got to Wembley and we lost on penalties. And the following season, we eventually got promoted. But something happened in my second year at Grimsby. And what happened was I lost my mother to mental health at the age of 50 in 2015. And I can remember when I got the news where the doctor came round and the doctor was saying, you know, you need to get your mum to hospital. I can remember going into hospital with my mother, and for those 17 days that she was in there, on the third day, the doctor came, pulled the family aside and says, "Look, it's bad news. You know, your mother might not make it out." And I didn't actually know that it was at the crisis point. And of course, I didn't have the amount of information available to me like I do now to be able to pull my mum out of her suffering and misery. And that's why I think I'm so passionate and dedicated to the work that I do now, attached to that. But I had two choices. I could either become victim or be victor. And I wanted to recycle all of that pain and turn it into something greater. So when I lost my mother to mental health, you know, I was obviously having this prayer life in private that I was doing. I started to question all that, you know, like any person would. I was in the hospital. I was on the end of life care with my mother, and 17 days, I just see her obviously deteriorating. And I can remember looking around in the room, and I spent 17 days by her side. And I can remember looking around, looking over my shoulder, thinking, God, like, if you're real, why are you putting me through this? Why me? And started having that kind of mentality. And I can remember thinking, gosh, my, you know, my guardian angels handed her notice in 2 weeks early. Like, this wasn't in the script for me. But again, I had a choice, and I had to understand that I would either become victim or victor. But in that, 5 days later, the manager rings me and says, you know, take as much time as you need off once my mother passed. And I went back out, and this image that you can see here was 5 days after I just lost my mother. And I took the courage, and I was vulnerable enough to go back out onto the stage. And this very night was a special night. I managed to score 2 goals and we won 2-1. And it's probably my greatest achievement, because it was about the character, and it was about being vulnerable enough to listen to what was, you know, calling me forward with my emotions and feelings, and having a driving force. And again, going back to the commitment side of things, when I lost my mother, that commitment just magnified. You know, it strengthened me. It was my driving force, because I knew that my mother would want me to go and live a purposeful life. So from there, I went and scored. About 8 months later, I scored the winning goal at Wembley to get us promoted to League Two. Again, you can see all the emotion pouring out, because true courage, and I'll say it later on, there's a quote, but true courage is starting something without any guarantees of success. And I think with football, you know, up until that point, there was no guarantees of success. But when you place one foot in front of the other and you stay committed and true to that, then great things can come from it. And certainly that was the case for me. And I went on to sign for Lincoln the following season, and we made history, was the first team in non-league to over 100 years to go and reach the quarterfinals of the FA Cup. Amazing. We knocked out Burnley here in this picture. Sean Regis scored a 90-minute winner. And then we eventually got knocked out by the mighty Arsenal at the Emirates in front of 60,000. And so football, you know, has been such a vehicle, a great vehicle for me to get me to where I am. And it's been absolutely fantastic. And from the time at Lincoln, when got to the last eight of the FA Cup, and we accumulated all this money, I think it was a couple of million pounds that we accumulated that season, innocently went on a radio show, got invited in by BBC Radio Lincolnshire, and talking football on a breakfast show. And then we moved into anxiety. Now, when I lost my mother, because I was the only male in the family, I was playing rescue, I wore the cape, and I made sure that my mum and sister was processing it okay, and they was going through a grieving process, but I left myself behind. And what happened was that a couple of years later, when I got to Lincoln, I went on holiday in the summer. I had a pain from one side of my shoulder to the other, and I had a pain across my chest. It was an anxiety attack. And I can remember thinking, gosh, like, I've repressed all my emotions. You know, I used to hear as a child, big boys don't cry, children should be seen, not heard. So I did it very well and just keeping my mouth closed and not expressing the way I was feeling. And I can remember for the very first time here, this picture on the left, I was 28 years old, and I give myself permission to speak out about the way I was feeling. Little did I know that the picture to your right, 4 days later, I got notifications and text messages after that breakfast show saying, me too, thank you for sharing your story. And I didn't realize the impact that it would have just by sharing my anxieties and stuff that I was going through, because in the football world, you get put on a pedestal, you know, you live up to this persona, you wear the mask. And I was a public success, but private failure. You know, I was highly successful on the pitch, but I wasn't being with my emotions. I wasn't actually working on myself in terms of those areas that needed attending to when it comes to the emotions. So I just laid my soul bare in front of 60 people. Now, played at the Emirates in front of 60,000, but stood up in front of 60 people, as you can imagine, was terrifying, especially when you're talking about yourself and you're putting the spotlight on yourself. But being vulnerable enough and courageous enough, what it led to do is to start to move me into this direction of giving service to others. So now I had a duty, I had a commitment to make. Again, talking about commitment, I needed to stay true to what I said I was going to do long after the mood I said it in has left, because a lot of the time in this line of work, you'll get people who are motivational and they'll go out and they'll speak and get people pumped up, which is good, but the feeling will subside. So it's giving messages to people that can land, that can sit there, that they can carry through to their future also. So I wanted to talk about commitment. I don't know if you've heard about the Chinese bamboo tree, but out in the Far East, there's a thing called a Chinese bamboo tree. And one day this guy went and planted a seed down in the ground. The seed had to go down into darkness. It had to germinate. And every day this guy would water and nurture this seed in the ground. But the bamboo tree is really fascinating because it takes 5 years to grow. But in the fifth year, when there's a breakthrough, it takes just 5 weeks to grow 90 feet tall. So this guy knew it was going to take 5 years. So this comes to commitment. This comes to sacrifice and dedication. When it comes to business, when it comes to your line of work, you can apply this metaphor, this analogy, this story. And this guy planted a seed every day, would attend it, would nurture, water it. And of course, 3 months went by, 6 months went by, and nothing was showing. People started to come by. People started to mock him. You're going to get criticized along the way. There's no results. Obviously, after a year, he's probably having an internal dialogue with himself saying, gosh, why don't I just give up? You know, nothing's showing. And then again, he had to remind himself to practice patience that it takes 5 years to grow. But he was having this dialogue, of course, this internal dialogue like we all do. But in the fifth year, something amazing happened. And the bamboo tree started to sprout, and it started to grow. And with just 5 weeks, it grew 90 feet tall. And I always say, is the question is, does the bamboo tree grow 90 feet tall in 5 years or 5 weeks? And the answer is very simple. Some people think it's 5 weeks, you know, but it's 5 years, because at any point in time, the man stopped watering and nurturing that seed in the ground, the tree would have died in the ground. And this is what we can use in business when it comes to work, whatever is on our heart, whatever we go on to do. It's about persisting, committing to it, because you're going to have people. I had family members what were saying, why did you make that decision? Such a bad decision. You're going to have people questioning you, people doubting you, even close friends doubting you, maybe because you're outgrowing them or you're going in a direction where they wish they had the courage to do it. So when you step into the arena, you are going to have a target on your back. If you choose to lead with your heart and show the courage and the determination to go after what it is that you're gifted with, and you go all in with that, you're going to have people that are going to want to pull you back. So remember the bamboo tree as a really good metaphor, as to understand that you have to practice patience, because there's a process to be had. And when you can trust, embrace and respect the process, that buys you time and patience in order to understand the bigger picture. And then it will keep you resilient. It will keep you committed and persevering. So I just wanted to share that with you. So here we go. True courage, having the ability to start something without any guarantees of success. I see so many people that I've coached, that I've worked with along the way in this last 18 months, 2 years. And what I've noticed is that people tiptoe into the process, and they don't give their all into it because they're not sure about the payoff at the end of it. Now, I'm fortunate enough to have found something that I love to do, that's called me forward to do this line of work. I'm fortunate enough to do that without expecting anything in return. I know that in 3 years time that I'm not just going to quit and give up. This is my calling. This is my purpose. And I think when you get aligned with that, then there's nothing that can stop you. And the only way, I can remember going to a life coach, and the only thing that was stopping me was me. And this life coach said to me on my very first visit, I was getting counseling at the time, and nothing would work. And I went to this guy who was 74 years old and lives in Lincoln. And he sat me down, and he just did compassionate listening for the first 45 minutes. He said, "Nath, and just tell me exactly what you're feeling, what's happened." And there I was blaming taxes, I was blaming the traffic, I was blaming the weather, I was blaming my father not being around. I had a pretty good blame list. It was pretty good. And he said to me after the 45 minutes, he said, "Okay," he said, "there's one problem with the list that you've reeled off." And I said, "What is it?" And he said, "You're not on it." And of course, that cut close to the bone. I was like, wow, no one's ever held the mirror up to me like that before. I've always blamed something outside of myself. And it wasn't until I scrapped that piece of paper and I said, the key to a meaningful, purposeful life is me. And I didn't blame anybody else. So true courage, again, the ability to start something without any guarantees of success. And we see it in all walks of life, and especially in football, you see very talented players that make it to the very top. And your talent will place you in a position that your character can't handle if you don't work on your character. So it's all about going in alignment with what you want to do, but then taking the necessary steps in order to achieve that goal by sacrifice, committing and dedicating yourself to that. So here's an illustration. Here's the road of life, and you come to a T-junction in your life where you have to make a decision. Okay, do I go down road A or do I go down road B? And let's say you go down road A and it leads you into a job, a career. Maybe it leads you into further education. Maybe you want to travel the world. Maybe it leads you into a relationship. Or maybe you just float without purpose. Seeing a lot of people come now in this Gen Z, this new generation, a lot of kids not knowing what they want to do after school, a lot of entrepreneurships, a lot of people going on their own. But whatever this is, so you go down road A or road B, and these are your options. Let's say you go down one of the roads, and then you come into some adversity, you come into some hardships, you come into setbacks, opposition, rejection, challenges. Guaranteed. You're either in a problem, just left a problem, or heading towards one. That is the harsh realities of this life. So you're going to face some challenges, some setbacks, some adversity along the way, whatever you decide to do. So what we tend to do is we look back in the rearview mirror and say, gosh, what a Nath, you stupid idiot. Why did you make that decision? You know, I wish I could rewind the clock and then make a different choice. But you see, you only made that decision based off the amount of information you had available at 18 years old, 19, 20, whenever that was. So what you've done now is now you start beating yourself up with guilt, with fear. Anxiety comes in and you start regretting your life. Start looking in the rearview mirror. And a lot of people, this can define them. Oh, I wish I had my time again. I would have done it differently. But what you've got to understand is that life is just a series of learning experiences. There's no mistakes. Okay, you might put it down to mistakes and failures. Okay, you might make a bad choice, but it's about growing and learning from them choices and actually getting the messages along the way, because life is just a series of learning experiences. So another example of this is the pit of despair that people fall into. Okay, and again, losing my mother to mental health, this is what happened. But living life with purpose, again, you avoid this. And this is the trap. So imagine you're here, you climb the ladders, and you're just walking along, drifting by, whether in a job or relationship or just floating without purpose. And you end up falling into the pit of despair. Well, what does that look like? It's when we attach blame to our circumstances, when we blame things. Like I did, I had a great blame list. Excuses is a pandemic in itself, blame-itis and excuse-itis. Justification, guarantee whatever's happened to this point in time in everybody's life, we can almost justify our rights to be angry, our rights to be jealous, our rights to be guilty, our rights to whatever it is. So we justify everything. And underneath all of that, we fall into victim consciousness. Why me? Why does it have to happen to me? And then what happens is that you'll get maybe a workshop, a seminar, a book. Maybe you'll meet somebody along the way that just offers you a little bit of a way out, ladders, that maybe holds the mirror up, that maybe you can resonate with something. And when you finally get the ladders and climb out of it, then you can go and live a meaningful, purposeful life. So what I would like for you guys to do now is imagine your loved ones gathered together after you are gone, maybe your children, partner, or other family members. What do you hear them saying about you? Write down what you think they might say about you and their lives with you. So I just encourage you at this point, guys, if you've got a notepad, pen and paper, if you haven't, just take a screenshot and do it in your own time. That's absolutely fine. I'm going to leave this page on, this screen on for the next 5 minutes. So it gives you time to write it down or take screenshots. But I'm just going to reel it off and I want you to participate in this. So number one, how will they describe your character? Number two, how will they describe your attitude towards life? Number three, what would they say your priorities were in life? When your children talk about you to their own children, or it could be family members if you've not got children, which of your characteristics do you hope they will develop? Number five, which of your characteristics do you hope they will not develop? And then look at your answers above. And ask yourself, is there anything that surprises you? Anything you wish you did differently? So I'm just going to leave that on for the time being. George, I'm not sure whether you wanted to just come in, mate, on this and allow anybody at this point in time to ask any questions or anything.
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you, Nathan. That was great. Really, for me personally, took a lot from that. And I think it was really interesting, particularly at the start when you talked about the two individuals that kind of and helped you and gave you decent advice when you were a child, and that was both your coach at Mansfield Town and the volunteer that you alluded to earlier. And I think for us as a network of people that are on this call could probably resonate with them you know, daily, in the fact that, you know, you talk about that commitment of having something to do, and actually the people on this call now that are listening are going to be those people that are giving that advice to young children that are having difficult times like yourself. So I think that was really powerful and something that a lot of people will hopefully have taken away from this as well. But yeah, I suppose, guys that are with us today, is there anything that you want to ask Nathan at all? Is there anything that stood out from Nathan that you'd like to maybe get a little bit more information on, a little bit more detail on? It'd be great to obviously speak up. Nathan, we have got a couple questions for you in the chat box on the right hand side. So
right, yeah, sure. What I'll do now is I'll move on. That's given enough people enough time to screenshot that. And I just think it's a really good exercise, guys, just to get yourself thinking, you know, what does my 85-year-old self look like when I look back on my life for the performance that I'm bringing now to the table? Is that a life that I want to live? And also the characteristics in that as well. I think when you actually look back on that, I think it really does make you live more purposefully. And again, living with purpose, this is about doing something that you want to do, but also understanding your characteristics along the way and how you can actually have such an impact. You, like George, you've just mentioned about those two guys in my life, you know, I'm sure you've all in a position where you can have that positive change and impact and long-lasting impact in people's lives. So this is just a really good exercise for that. So what I'll do, George, is I'll just come back onto the video and I'll just come back into the room. I'll get rid of this, stop sharing my screen. And yeah, if you just want to open it up for people to, you know, ask any questions or anything like that, then feel free.
Yeah, brilliant. So if you, I know we guys just probably maybe thinking of a question or two, Nathan, in the chat box, we've had a couple questions for you, which I can read to you now. So Dean had asked you, and this might be my poor knowledge here, but what would you recommend to a 20-year-old playing in the UCL Div 1 at the moment? So I don't know if that means more to you than it does to me, but is there any advice you'd have for Dean on that question?
Is that, you know, I think that's the United Counties League Division One. If I'm right in saying that, I'm currently manager at Melton Town in the UCL Division One. I'm not quite sure whether it's the same league as Dean or not, but this is Melton Mowbray, so Leicestershire region. So what advice would I give? Is that what you said, George? What advice would I give to him at 20?
Yeah.
Was this professionally or personally? Is this just a generalized question?
It's quite general, but I think maybe if you a bit of both would be quite insightful. Is there if it's something that Dean's looking for his own kind of personal performance, or is it something that's going to help him with his potential outlook and his own attitude and commitment in regards to his performance, I would imagine?
Yeah, sure. Again, going back to the sea turtle, we're all born with a gift. I always believe that we're all unique. So, you know, finding something that, you know, Dean loves to do, obviously, is probably at a point where he's looking to improve and develop. And what I say is just walk your own walk and make sure that, you know, you make that commitment and sacrifice and dedication, because we live in the world today where it's text week and twerk world, where there's distractions everywhere, especially with social media. So I just think really just have tunnel vision and go for whatever is calling you forward. You know, like, it's so easy to overanalyze and overthink things, but really go with your gut feeling. And when you do that, preparation is key. You know, when it comes to having confidence and building the confidence within inside yourself, it comes from leaving no stone unturned through preparation. So just master whatever area of your life that you want to go in. Just master that. And again, you're going to have to upgrade, you know, like the iPhone, you might have to upgrade some friendships. You know, if you're the smartest one in your circle, get a new circle. You know, it's about stretching yourself out, surrounding yourself with like-minded people or people with way more knowledge than you that are going to stretch you out. And it gives you the opportunity to grow, to learn, to develop, because that's what I believe as human beings that we're here for, is to continuously look at where we can improve. And it's not unhealthy where it's an obsession, but it's about, again, purpose and living your life, taking deliberate action and actually moving towards whatever goal that you have.
Great. And I think we just had I'm going to skip down the chat just a little bit because the question that's just come in, I think, is a good one for us to focus on. And it's what has helped you to focus in every game. And I think the reason why that is a question that hopped out for me is because for yourself, obviously, at the start of your career, that was every game, you know, that was every challenge. And I think for us on the call, it's potentially not a game, but that game might be a metaphor for another challenge that we might face. And what is it that kind of helped you to maintain focus, and also probably upon leaving your football career as well, is actually readjust, if that's the right word, your focus into something else?
Yeah, so when I made the transition from football into the line of work that I do now, all I'm doing is transferring my values, my attitude, my behaviours, you know, my self-belief, everything over to this line of work. So even though the career has changed, I've been repositioned and reinvented myself, still those core principles stay, if that makes sense. So what kept me focused? I just think if you ask yourself this question, why do you do what you do? You know, and when you can answer that question, then it just ignites something inside of you where you have that burning desire. And of course, there's tools along the way. There's things that I used to do in terms of visualization and other tools that I talk about on my 6-week mentorship programs. But it's just trying to figure out why you're doing what you're doing, you know. And for me, I had a legacy attached to it. I wanted to pull my mum and nan out of certain situations, going into fatherhood, not having a father for 20 years, you know. Am I going to just repeat that cycle, or am I going to set the bar high enough for my children to reach and break that cycle where the buck stops with me and take accountability and responsibility? And going back to the image that I shown you of the pit of despair, making excuses, blaming, justifying, and falling into victim consciousness, it's so easy. That is such a trap. But when you start to take ownership and participate in your own rescue, wherever you have a setback, a challenge, you know, you're redirected, there's a diversion, there's an obstacle, it's always about looking at ways of improving rather than saying, why me, and let it derail you. It's about trusting exactly what your why is that is attached to it. So going back to it, it's about finding out why you do what you do. And if that why is strong enough, that will always keep you moving forward in the right direction.
Brilliant. Great. And yeah, that's something that we as an organization, we do focus on is what is our why? Why do we do what we do? So I'm sure that's a message, hopefully, that again has resonated with everybody on the call. Is there anybody that would like to physically ask Nathan a question? Come off your mic and ask. It'd be great to have some engagement from you. We've got about 30. Bradley, is that yes in the chat box? If you unmute yourself, Bradley, and then you can ask away.
Hi, Nathan.
Hi, Bradley.
Hi, yes. Fortunately, I've been able to see you live at Wembley in 2015. Sort of, obviously, unfortunately, you lost the game on penalties. What was the motivation the next year? Because obviously, I remember in the game, you were the much better team. So when you played in the following year, I was cheering on Grimsby, hopefully, to win the game.
Yeah, no, great question. And like, it was amazing for you to share that. And actually, you have, you know, was at Wembley that day, which I'm sure was a fantastic day, albeit we, you know, didn't get the result that we all wanted. So what kept us going? I think it's the fact, again, like when I talk about setbacks and challenges, you're going to get that. That is part of life. And I think, you know, it's about utilizing that pain, and it's about using it as fuel, as, you know, so that burning desire just deepened, because again, it's about persevering, it's persisting. Again, the bamboo tree analogy, it's about having an end goal, and the end goal was to get promoted. So the fact that you just have to make sure that you are the living example of, again, matching your words with your actions. You know, if the coach says to me, do 10 push-ups, I'm doing 11, 12 push-ups. You know, I'm not doing 8. I'm not shortchanging it. I'm not cutting corners. If anything, I'm doing more than what I'm getting told to do. And so it's about finding a way through the adversity, the setbacks, the challenges, to find the actual, you know, the beauty in it, because I always think that there's a hidden treasure in every experience. You just have to find that hidden treasure. There's always something in there that you can learn and take from that can amplify your life or can change your life for the better, or you can actually use as fuel to drive you forward. And again, not falling into victim consciousness and not saying, oh, feeling defeated and feeling sorry for yourself, but actually standing back up, placing one foot in front of the other and going again. And then fortunately for us as a team, having that mentality and that mindset and persevering, we stand, you know, under the arch and lift the trophy the following season, you know, 10 months later, 12 months later. So it is just about placing one foot in front of the other and just keep persisting. Thank you.
We've got one. We'll do one more now. I can't see who that was in the chat box, but if you just speak up when you're ready.
George, I've got a bit of a question, if you don't mind. Nathan, my question is more maybe business related, but so your business plan now and where your drive, I suppose, for this next year or 5 years, however long your goal is, when maybe you get a setback or something doesn't go right within your plan and maybe your mindset slips slightly, I suppose, what have you got any kind of tips or what do you do to kind of, I suppose, engage your mind again or get that correct mindset and carry on driving forward? Because obviously at the moment where it's really uncertain times and things like that, you know, we can plan so far down the line and then maybe a school or something pulls out of your plan. What do you kind of do to push yourself forward and keep driving?
So what's your name? Is it John Cahill?
Yeah,
brilliant. Thank you for that question. Great question, especially for everybody listening. I'm going to try and answer it the best I can. I think that we have a lot of people in society that are driven by results. We have a lot of people in society that are driven by materialistic and superficial things, and there's nothing wrong with that. But the moment they don't get it, they're not the same individual. And again, going back to character, because you can lose the money, you can lose the job, you can lose the relationship. And if you are self-generated, means that you can look inwardly and have the tools and be resilient and work on yourself diligently. Whatever external happens, what are out of your control, it won't derail you. And I think I've been fortunate enough when I talked about when I was 24 years old, having a bit of a spiritual awakening, if you like. Again, I'm not, never stepped foot in a church, I'm not a religious person, but just understood that my selfish prayers then turned into what I was grateful for, thankful for. And obviously I started to develop those areas with my mindset. And so when it comes to this line of work now, we're in a state of anticipation, of course, with the pandemic, but I'm looking at ways of improving. I've actually got all my content and just picked it apart to improve it and looking at ways to get better rather than just being stagnant and just sort of living in fear and worry, because that's what you can't control. All I can control now is what I do and putting myself in a position where I'm ready. And it's better to be prepared and not have an opportunity than to have an opportunity and not be prepared. So I think one thing that what I did personally was I started to have a relationship with me. I dated me and I got to understand me, and I started to look at all the areas that need attending and improving. Because imagine a garden, you know, you're looking in other people's gardens. I want what Sam's got, and Sam wants what James has got, and James wants what Susie's got. But yet you forget to attend your own garden, and then the weeds are growing all around your shoes and around your legs, but yet you're looking at everybody else. And I think the best advice I could give is just constantly work on you. It's a full-time job working on yourself. And over time, through consistency of doing that, you'll develop the mindset, the belief, the confidence, the resilience that you need. So then when challenging times happen like this that are out of your control, it won't move you. And, you know, people could, you know, I could lose the job, the money, the car, the house, whatever it is, but you are the product, you know, you are. And it's about becoming and developing yourself to the point where you ain't looking to be manipulated or controlled by external things. And of course, that is a difficult concept to accept sometimes when you're in business and, you know, you've got a manager, you've got the CEOs and all of that. I had that at Lincoln City. But I just think when you give yourself permission to be you and to trust and believe in it and respect that there's a process, then I just think it's all about your character, because then that will take you a lot further than, you know, than the other things. So I hope I've answered your question, John. Thank you.
Yeah, no, that's great. Thank you.
Brilliant. Right, I'm just going to check the chat box one last time so we can see something's going on. Oh, we've got a couple more. Is there anyone else have more questions? If you haven't, after this call is over. So there's a question there around being able to ask more questions. And I suppose, Nathan, it's probably an opportunity just to show. Obviously, Nathan has obviously got his own website, which we've shared the link for multiple times, which I can share again for you in just a moment. But obviously, that's an opportunity to, I suppose, Nathan, if I'm right in saying, is to potentially the forum to, if they wanted to speak to yourself. Oh, brilliant. Perfect time there. So you can see some information on there. So I'm sure Nathan would be happy for you to contact him regarding anything away from today's call. I've also posted in there a very short survey for you all to complete. And one of the questions in there is if you would like Nathan to come and do some more support for your business, or potentially again on someone like TWP-TV, just to leave your email address and I can pass your details on to Nathan directly. So if you complete that, that will be something that I can liaise with Nathan with. But yeah, is there anything you'd like to add to that, Nathan, at all?
No, that's brilliant.
Sorry,
and yeah.
Sorry, I just wanted to, sorry to interrupt. Nathan, would you do anything like, I know you said you go into schools and kind of do presentations and things.
Yeah.
If we were to have, would you do that for our organisations, if you like? So if we had a couple of schools in mind with that, I know there might be a fee and things like that, but would you, is that something you kind of offer at the moment or?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I don't just want to just target one area. Like, you know, I try and I always say to people, I've reached far enough down into my own soul to be effective. And what I mean by that, and I don't mean to become across, you know, cocksure or anything like that. But what I'm saying is the hardships that I've endured have allowed me to be well equipped and prepared for whatever audience that I go into, whether it's business, whether it's football teams, college, universities, prisons. You know, I'm able to adapt the content and the programs that I have in order to reach the needs of people. So yeah, absolutely. What I tend to do is I run mentorship programs. So again, I could maybe share the mentorship program with you as well, if that's beneficial for the school. If not, obviously I can just obviously share whatever it is that you need. That's absolutely fine.